gratitude, actually. We were just talking about a, you know, gratitude special.
Yeah.
I am just really grateful to be an alcoholic right now because I have a thing that I can turn to, like a program and a community of people I can turn to, that all are going through basically the same thing that I'm going through. And we have a sort of set of solutions, steps even, if you will, that work for this, that work much better for me than chemicals did. And other people don't have that set solution for themselves necessarily. I mean, they can find something like it in other kinds of communities and spiritual communities and meditation, perhaps in just meditative prayer. But you know, I have a place to go and a list of things to do that help me with feelings of hopelessness, which are really familiar to me, you know, predating the Trump era for sure. I have found myself praying more, to be honest, and practicing the kind of prayer and meditation that might be familiar to, you know, the spiritual source of New Yorkers as like loving kindness meditation, where you try to project into the world a feeling of loving and of kindness, which feels really missing lately, you know. And I have found myself just wanting to put more of that out into the world.
And that's good advice for others, too, in that regard, for sure. And listeners, we can take calls on that, among other things, for Anna Marie Cox. Have you been drinking more in 2017 as a way of coping with world affairs? Is it creating a problem for you or someone you know because the news becomes a trigger for self-medication beyond what's actually okay for you? Is there a New Year's resolution in the making right now around this, or add to Anna Marie's advice for coping when the news is a trigger so you don't fall into self-destructive habits? 212-433-WNYC, 212-433-9692. And Anna Marie, by way of segue, I guess, what do you think of Trump telling the New York Times that he has the absolute right to do anything he wants with the Justice Department?
Oh, boy. I guess you've probably been following the very heated discussion on Twitter last night, this morning, between journalists about what to do with such quotes. I wish someone had asked him what he means by that. I think he, you know, by our traditions, he does not have the absolute right. But, you know, no one's ever tested it, and it looks like he might test it. You know, it's funny, like, I think one of the reasons why Trump does just sort of, like, barrel through norms is I do think on some level he literally does not know what the norms are surrounding the presidency. I think he was disappointed to find he's not king. I wonder if someone should have told him more about what the office was like. I mean, I guess the conventional wisdom is if you tell Trump you can't do something, he'll just do it. But I would even feel some more comfort if I thought he knew what he was ignoring. But I think he's just ignorant. And that's somehow more terrifying.
Yeah. By now, I think he knows. And he even praised, in the context of that quote as it went on, Eric Holder for being so loyal to President Obama. In the he was, you know, at once accusing Holder of corruption without using that word by not being an impartial arbiter of justice as the U.S. Attorney General. At once accusing him of that and saying that Jeff Sessions should do the same for him. So.
Right. Yeah.
I don't think we can give him the excuse of being naive anymore.
Well, I don't know if it's naive exactly. It's sort of like willful, like it's willful ignorance, right? It's like I don't know if he really realizes that he's contradicting himself. Like, I'm really unsure of the state of his mind. Like, I would just like to hear more from him. Like, I'm not one of those people that thinks he needs to be grilled. I think if my approach in an interview with Trump would be to tell him the truth, which is like, I don't follow you. Could you please explain that further? I'm not sure. Are you really saying that you wish Jeff Sessions was more like Trump? And in what way, or more like
Holder?
And in what way do you mean that?
Yeah, that would have been a good follow-up question. And what do you make of Trump saying the Times and other media will start tilting toward him for re-election because another 4 years will be good for ratings and sales?
Well, I mean, maybe there he's not wrong. I mean, isn't that what Jeff Zucker said, right? About the characters that in the drama that CNN was portraying. I don't think it's done consciously.
And Les Moonves, head of CBS, said during the campaign, Trump may be bad for America, but he's great for CBS.
Yeah, I don't think it's done as consciously as Trump seems to think. But you know, I mean, you're a press critic too. The American press, I mean, probably most media in the world, leans towards drama and wanting to cover controversy and wanting to cover personalities, and that's what happened in 2016. And what happened, you know, the result of that was Trump winning. If 2020 turns into a drama of people, it is hard to imagine a more compelling character than Donald Trump, right? Like, it really is. He is fascinating. For some of us, against our better judgment. So if it turns into a referendum on who the American people want to watch on television more, yeah, you know, I mean, I just hope it doesn't turn into that. And I think journalists can help shift the conversation if we are conscious about it.
Anna Marie Cox, my guest, host of the podcast With Friends Like These. Maybe you know her from her past work, founder of the website Wonkette, New York Times Magazine contributor, things on TV these days, host of the podcast With Friends Like These, and 212-433-WNYC, 433-9692, and Aviva in Manhattan. You're on WNYC with Anna Marie. Hi, Aviva.
Hi, thank you for this wonderful session and for all of your great work. Well, I'm an ecological artist, and it could not be a more difficult time to be an ecological artist. I do work a number of 12-step programs as well, and I have to say that this morning I had some dark chocolate. I find this impossibly difficult to just try to navigate. It seems that spiritual programs, yes, indeed, that's the only way to live with what's going on, to think of this for whatever we do as for the seventh generation, even if we don't know there's going to be a seventh generation at this point with what we're doing to the environment. And yet we have to carry on. I think it's really important to say that there just is no answer right now, even spiritually. We do our best, and maybe you can work a perfect program. I know I can't. It's just too devastating every single day. Every single word out of that monster's mouth creates more PTSD for me and most of the people I know and work with. And yet we carry
PPSD.
On. And so I guess I can say I'm really grateful for your program.
PPSD.
That I'm not the only one going stark raving.
PPSD.
I would like to say, for one thing, I do not work a perfect program. And indeed, a piece of wisdom that I once heard in the rooms is if you're trying to do a program perfectly, you're probably not doing it right. Which is to say, you know, progress, not perfection in all things. And by a solution, I guess I only mean that it does help me cope. It helps me get through day to day. And it gives me hope. It gives me hope because, you know, I find it to be miraculous that I am sober today. And if I can stay sober today, if my head hit the pillow sober last night, and if that's possible, then all things are possible. And I have hope. I don't have hope necessarily for today or tomorrow. I think you're right, we have to have a very long view. But you can't have the long view without a minimum of hope for today. And I do find that not just sort of in my spirituality, but also in the fact of these programs that are available and these communities that exist. Not just communities in 12-step programs, but communities in faith, communities in volunteering, communities of people that come around the same coffee shop every morning. One of the things that I've advised people who tell me they're hopeless right now is to do volunteer work, and especially volunteer work that may not have anything to do with politics. Do something that you love. The thing that I often suggest is being a dog walker or working at your local shelter, because doing something that you love just puts good into the world. I do believe that, and puts you in contact with people, who are also doing something that they love, and you can connect about that. And that connection is what keeps us human. And I also believe that these communities and these connections are what help us withstand totalitarianism and authoritarianism. Because what those two things do is dehumanize and atomize. Every time you can make a connection to another human, you are striking a blow against authoritarianism. I do believe that. So you, right here, have done that. You calling in and being vulnerable, you have done that. You have done something good in the world today. You have, as they say, resisted. But I would say you've done even more than that, more than resist. Like, you have done a positive good in the world.
Wow. Aviva, I hope that helps at least a little. Robert in Queens, you're on WNYC. Hi, Robert.
Hi, how are you? Can you hear me okay?
We can hear you fine.
Yeah, great. Yeah, I was listening to the program and thinking about myself being sober. I've been sober now for 27 years. And I keep thinking to myself, there's not anything in the world that would make me want to pick up a drink right now, because I know where that will lead me. And you asked about people, because Trump is in office, drinking more. You know, alcoholics, I always say this, alcoholics, we tend to be like, if I get out of bed and I stub my toe and I drink, I'm going to do that. And it's not gonna take a person like Trump to make me drink. If I want to drink, I'm going to drink, you know? And, you know, I think what happens is that because of admitting that, you know, there is something that's bigger than me that I can't fight, that's that first step in the 12 steps. I mean, I always say step one, I can't. Step two, he can. Step three, I'll get in touch. You know, that's how I do it on a daily basis. And I'm not like a big book dumper or anything else like that, but the fact of the fact is that I just can't drink and safety, or take the drug in safety. I think Anna Maria was one of the people that mentioned that.
Right.
I do find it very frustrating from time to time when you know, I see people in, like I was telling you, screener, that on the corner where I pulled over when we were having this conversation, there's a guy standing, it's 17 degrees, and the guy's strung out, and he's like, that's his life right now. If there was more compassion in the world, if we had compassionate leaders in the world that realized that we have to put people first before egos, then maybe we would be on the road to doing something really profound with one another. But we're at a state right now where, just like you were saying, where you start to feel down, you have to do something for somebody else. I always listen to another person who's struggling, or I go to a meeting and I listen to a newcomer and try to sit down and talk or have a cup of coffee with somebody. That always works, because it takes the focus off of what I'm thinking.
Nicely said, Robert, really nicely said. And again, I think really helpful for a lot of other folks out there. We're almost out of time. Anna Maria, I want to give you a second to mention your other new venture, Space the Nation, the back catalog of science fiction as a way of processing the news.
Yes. You know, it is, I think, a running joke on, you know, among all of us, that this seems like a different reality. There's lots of jokes about how on Earth 2, you know, Hillary is president, and this timeline really sucks, and this simulation is terrible. And I think I was listening to people talk like that, and I thought, you know, what are the ways that science fiction has anticipated or understood the kinds of things that we're experiencing now? And so I'm going to take just a different topic in the news every week and look for ways that science fiction has tried to help us understand it. This week, or next week's, is about people selecting their own realities, you know, ideological bubbles or information silos. But I'll also do things like abortion and artificial intelligence and military purges. You know, science fiction is all about headlines more than it is about the future. It really does help us try to deal with the here and now. It's a speculative fiction, and it uses the future as its canvas, but, you know, the paints are the news of the day.
I already love, by the way, some of the tweets from your fans in response.